Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Heart of Malice by Lisa Edmonds. Narrated by Felicity Munroe. Chapter 1. I was just finishing my second beer when someone leaned down to whisper in my ear, "Want to do something insane?" As pickup lines went, it wasn't half bad. I set my glass on the bar and looked up. He was dark-haired, gorgeous, and tall, dwarfing me by almost a foot, and at 5'6" plus heels, I wasn't exactly short. I took a moment to savor the close-up view of his impressively muscled chest and let my appreciation show in my voice when I answered, "Absolutely." He drained the last of his bourbon and tossed a crisp hundred on the bar next to our empty glasses. "Then let's get out of here." I let him help me slide down off my bar stool. His eyes moved approvingly from my tall boots to my thighs and over my short dress to my cleavage, where they paused for a moment before meeting my gaze. "Scott," he said, and held my jacket while I put it on. I smiled up at him. "Alice." "Nice to meet you, Alice." He offered his hand and I took it. We plowed through the crowded bar toward the front door. When we finally emerged on the sidewalk, I tucked my arm through Scott's and fell in step beside him. Despite the cold, he didn't need a coat. I felt his warmth even through my leather jacket. He smelled smoky and woodsy, like a forest fire. "What's on the agenda?" I asked as we strolled along 9th Street, past a dozen bars and late-night cafes.
"Have you ever flown the 101?
I laughed. "I've driven the Pacific Coast Highway. I didn't know you could fly it." He grinned at me.
"In my car, we can."
"Let's do it." I squeezed his arm. "Where are you parked?"
"Up ahead, a couple of blocks."
The March wind was bitterly cold on my bare legs. Though we walked quickly, within minutes I was shivering.
"Come on, we're almost there."
Scott squeezed me against his side with an enormous arm. "How did you manage to get parking down here on a Saturday anyway?" I asked, pouting a bit. "I'm all the way over on Fulton, in a pay lot."
"I know the guy who owns McGovern's Steakhouse," Scott replied. "He lets me park in his alley whenever I'm here."
"Well, that sure is convenient." Scott flashed me a smile. We were in front of McGovern's, which was already closed for the night. At 1 a.m., there weren't many pedestrians around. It was cold enough that anyone who was out was in a hurry to get where they were going, and the most popular bars were back in the direction we'd come from. Where Scott was parked, there was nothing but long closed restaurants and shops. I saw one other couple about a block behind us, wrapped in long coats, their heads down as they talked quietly, but no one else was in sight. The sharp staccato sound of my boot heels echoed as we walked. Finally, we rounded the corner and started into the alley behind the steakhouse. It was a relief to be out of the wind. Ahead, by the light of a single streetlight, I saw a black Porsche 911 Turbo parked in front of a large sign that read, "Authorized Vehicles Only." "Nice car," I remarked as we approached it.
"Thanks,"
he said, and punched me. I felt him tense up and managed to turn a fraction of a second before he swung, so his massive fist connected with my side instead of my stomach. Pain exploded in my ribs. I gasped and hit Scott's chest with both hands. Magic flared and he flew backward into the side of the restaurant, leaving a man-sized crater in the brick wall. He landed in a crouch with a snarl, his eyes blazing bright red. My left side hurt so badly it was hard to think for a moment, and I wondered if he'd broken any ribs. I held my side and spooled my earth magic. Green flames sparked on my skin as a 5-foot-long whip-like stream of cold fire emerged from my right hand. I lashed the Porsche's front tire, and it split with a loud bang and the hiss of air escaping. I smiled grimly.
No quick getaways for him.
Bitch,
Scott growled. His voice was deeper and more gravelly now that he was no longer pretending to be human.
My car.
I guess you won't be flying the 101 anytime soon, I said. And by the way, that's a terrible line. The half-demon glowered at me. Above us, the streetlight buzzed and flickered.
What do you want?
He demanded. You're coming with me. I've got a court summons with your name on it. His eyes glowed brighter with anger.
I don't answer to the humans,
he snarled. The corner of my mouth turned up. No, the other court. Scott hissed. I tensed and shifted my weight, ready for him to attack. Instead, the bastard ran. I cursed and took off down the alley after him, feeling a burst of sharp pain in my side with every step. My boots and short dress might have worked well to catch his attention in the bar, but they were far from ideal for a foot chase. By the time I reached the end of the alley, Scott was already almost a full block ahead of me. As we ran down the deserted sidewalk, headed farther from the relative safety of the bar district and possible witnesses, I set my jaw and blocked out the pain. Scott Grierson was not getting away from me tonight. Not after all he had done. Up ahead, Scott darted across the street. Between gasping breaths, I groaned. He was headed for Fields Park. If I lost sight of him in there, he was gone. I put on an extra burst of energy, breaking into a full sprint. Half-demons were larger and stronger than humans, but it was heavy muscle mass. They might get off to a fast start, but they weren't built for running long distances. By the time Scott ran through the gates of the park, I'd cut the distance separating us in half. The moon, a day from being full, hung bright in the clear sky, and I could see my quarry ahead of me, his steps crunching in the gravel path. Scott heard me gaining on him and suddenly veered off the main path toward some trees. I cut across the grass, hoping to intercept him before he found cover. Behind me, I thought I heard running footsteps back near the gate, but couldn't turn to look. If he had an accomplice, I'd deal with that when I had to. Right now, I couldn't chance him getting away. When I got within 20 feet, I raised my hands. White magic sparked on my palms, and I unleashed a gust of air that sent the half-demon sprawling into the grass with a surprised grunt. Scott rolled to his feet with a growl and turned to face me. His eyes glowed brightly in the darkness.
Who sent you?
I stopped 10 feet away, breathing hard. I'm here because of Maggie.
Who?
I couldn't see his expression clearly, but his tone sounded genuinely puzzled and it infuriated me. Maggie Hill, the girl you picked up a month ago from the same bar we were just in? Scott grinned. Unfortunately for them, a lot of women had found his smile to be charming. Of course, they hadn't seen it paired with his red eyes. At least, not until it was too late.
Was that her name? I had no idea.
My jaw clenched so hard that it hurt. Did you know any of their names? Maggie? Allison? Katie?
Nope,
Scott said with a shrug.
Honestly, I didn't care. I don't even know what your name is.
Suddenly, his arm moved. A flash of metal glinted in the moonlight, and I lashed out with my cold fire whip. The bright green arc of lightning intercepted the blade in midair and sent it flying back in the direction it came from, and buried it to the hilt in the half-demon's right eye. It was over in a heartbeat. For a moment, Scott remained upright, his single red eye wide open in surprise. Then he fell backward and landed on the grass with a solid thump. I approached him warily, my whip still crackling at my side. The half-demon was dying. His remaining eye stared up at me, glowing faintly. Dark blood ran from his right eye socket, where a 4-inch knife handle protruded. His mouth moved, but nothing came out. My fingers itched to pull the knife out and put it through his other eye. Instead, I crouched next to him as my whip coiled back into my hand and vanished. Disappointment left a bitter taste in my mouth. He didn't deserve a quick death. It should have been slow and painful. Maggie deserved that, at least. "My name," I told him coldly, "is Alice." Scott exhaled in a long, rattling wheeze. His eye dimmed, then went dark. I sat on the grass next to the body while I caught my breath. Pain lanced through my side, and the chill of the night started to seep into me. Running had made me sweat, and now the wind felt icy on my damp skin. My jaw ached from clenching my teeth, and my fingers dug into the ground in frustration. "Damn it, Alice!" I chastised myself. When Scott threw the knife, I'd acted to defend myself, drawing on years of training that had become instinct. Unfortunately, as a result, he'd escaped justice. And now, instead of presenting him to the vampire court as my prisoner, he would have to be tried ex mortem. I hoped the hills could at least find some answers and closure from that. Time to call the vamps to come get the body. I reached into my pocket for my phone. I heard footsteps running from the tree line a half second before two flashlight beams blinded me.
"Spima, hands on your head."
The voice was loud and male, its tone unmistakable. My night had just gone from bad to infinitely worse. Slowly, I pulled my hand out of my pocket, showed that it was empty, and clasped my hands on top of my head, half expecting to hear gunshots ring out and bracing for bullets that never came. Through the glare of the flashlights, I saw two dark figures in long coats, both pointing guns at me. "My name is Alice Worth," I said calmly over the pounding of my heart. "I'm a licensed private investigator and a registered earth and air mage. My ID is in my wallet in the left pocket of my jacket."
"Do not move,"
the other agent, a woman, warned me. I kept my hands on my head as the larger of the two shadows moved the beam of his flashlight to point at Scott Grierson's face. He swore and walked over to check the half-demon's pulse.
"Dead. God damn it, did you have to kill him?"
I blinked. I wasn't dumb enough to admit anything, even self-defense, in front of two federal agents. But the frustration and anger in his tone made me think these two hadn't just happened to be taking a late-night walk in the park. I looked closer at them, and then it clicked.
"You were following us back on 9th, I said slowly. "Why?"
No reply. Not that I'd really expected one. These two federal agents were the couple I'd seen as we walked from the bar to Scott's car. I remembered hearing footsteps behind me on the path in the park. Had the agents seen and heard the entire thing? And who had they been following? Scott or me? The male agent held me at gunpoint while his partner walked around behind me. She was a few inches taller than me, built solidly, wearing a long coat over a dark suit.
"On your feet, slowly," she ordered me.
I heard metal clinking. Carefully and a bit stiffly, I stood. She grabbed my left wrist and twisted my arm down behind my back. The movement made pain flare in my side.
"You're under arrest," she said, closing a spell cuff on my wrist.
She pulled my right arm down and cuffed it, too. The instant the first cuff closed on my wrist, my magic was suppressed, and I jerked in the agent's grip as the dampening spell settled on my skin like an itchy blanket. The discomfort made my stomach churn. Once I was cuffed, the female agent recited the Miranda warning, and I acknowledged with a simple yes that I understood my rights. She went through my pockets, starting with my wallet.
"Alice Evelyn Worth," she told her partner. "Mage private investigator's license, Spira registration, and current permits. Are you carrying any weapons or spells?"
"Air magic healing spell and spell cuffs in my right pocket," I said. "No weapons." When my arms started to ache, I laced my fingers together and tried not to pull on the cuffs.
They drained your strength if you did, which was why I'd planned to use a pair on Scott. They worked well to restrain half-demons, vampires, and others with superhuman strength. Between the cuffs and a sleep spell, I should have been able to get Scott Grierson to the vamps without much trouble. I glared at the half-demon's body. I ought to have just dropped him the instant we got into the alley instead of waiting until we were completely out of sight from the street. The consequences of my hesitation grew more dire by the second. The agent continued the search, dropping each item, including my cell phone, in the grass as she went through my jacket pockets. Then she frisked me very efficiently and thoroughly. When her hand slid over my ribs, I had to bite the inside of my cheek to keep from flinching. The male agent, who had been crouching next to Scott's body, stood and came over. He was well over 6 feet tall and blonde, wearing a long coat and dark suit like his partner. He picked up my wallet and read through its contents for himself.
"Alice Worth," he said quietly, as if to himself.
Then he looked at me, his eyes hard.
"Were you with him?"
he asked, hooking his thumb at the body. I kept my mouth shut. If I had the right to remain silent, I was going to use it. The male agent looked over my shoulder at his partner behind me. Whatever unspoken conversation they had, he didn't like it. His scowl deepened, and he stared at me. I fixed my gaze on his chin and stayed still, even though the discomfort of the spell cuffs and the pain in my side made me want to shuffle my feet. Finally, he grunted, pulled out his own identification, and stuck it under my nose.
"Special Agent Lake of the Supernatural and Paranormal Entity Management Agency," he said brusquely. "My partner is Special Agent Parker. We believe Mr. Grierson might have been involved in a series of disappearances in the area."
I said nothing. A muscle moved in Lake's square jaw.
"Since August of last year, we have 6 cases of young women going missing. A few days ago, we obtained camera footage from an ATM that showed the latest victim, Maggie Hill, on the night she disappeared, with a male suspect we believe to be Grierson. If you have any information tying him to these disappearances, or know anything about the whereabouts of these women, now is the time."
I thought about it. As with most soups and mages, my distrust of SPEMA agents ran deep. They had nearly limitless power and authority, and we had so few rights. I was acutely aware that Lake and Parker could haul me off and I would disappear into one of the agency's soup prisons, never to be seen or heard from again. I'd killed Grierson in self-defense, by accident, really. But it would be difficult to prove that. As such, I wasn't particularly inclined to say anything. The longer I stayed silent, the angrier Lake got. He stepped closer to loom over me.
"I can take you down to our office if you'd be more comfortable talking to me there," he said grimly.
We both knew my comfort didn't figure into the equation, and the odds of me walking back out of the agency office were slim at best.
"I want some answers. I've got 6 families waiting for news, and so help me, if you know what happened and you're not telling me, I will find a way to get it out of you."
I stared at him, my face blank. He'd gone from intimidation to explicit threats in a blink. Neither was anything new to me. If he expected me to be rattled, he was destined to be disappointed. I'd spent the first 24 years of my life being threatened with, and suffering, far worse torments than he could even begin to imagine.
"Forget it," Parker said. "She isn't going to tell us anything. Let's go."
She yanked on my cuffed wrists, and I barely suppressed a wince. Lake held up his hand and met my gaze. The anger in his eyes faded, replaced with grim determination. He sighed.
"We saw what happened," he told me.
From behind me, Parker made a disgusted noise. She let go of my arm and stepped back as if to distance herself from Lake.
"We overheard you tell him that you were here because of Maggie, and we heard him confess to taking the girls," Lake said. "We saw him throw the knife, You didn't mean to kill him. You were protecting yourself. If I take those cuffs off you, will you tell me what you know?
For God's sake, Lake, Parker exploded. You can't do that.
I can, and I will, Lake snapped. You want to go back and tell them we don't know where their girls are?
Parker stayed silent.
Do you?
Lake demanded.
No, but...
Take the cuffs off.
Lake glowered at Parker. A full minute passed. Apparently, Lake won the staring contest, because suddenly I heard a jingle of keys. I braced myself, but when the cuffs came off, the surge of released magic caused me to stagger before Lake caught me by my left arm. Before I could stop myself, I grimaced at the pain in my side as my weight pulled on my arm.
Are you injured?
Lake's eyes narrowed as he looked at me.
No.
I pulled away from him and forced myself to stand up straight. Just stiff from the cuffs. If he thought I was hurt, he might try to force me to go to the hospital, and that was something I had to avoid. Lake looked like he wasn't sure he believed me, but lucky for me, he was more interested in Grierson than any bumps or bruises, or cracked ribs, that I might have.
Tell me what you know.
I'd thought at first that Lake's change in attitude was simply a tactic to get me to talk, but he looked sincere. Grierson was dead, and as far as the agent knew, so were his chances of finding out where Maggie and the other girls were. My instincts were telling me that Lake cared far more about finding them than about throwing me in prison for accidentally killing a half-demon. My only way out of this might be to tell him what I knew. I was about to take a very big and very uncharacteristic gamble with my freedom and my life. 2 weeks ago, I was hired by Maggie Hill's parents to look for their missing daughter. They were frustrated by the lack of progress the task force was making and thought a private investigator might be more successful. Behind me, Parker made a derisive sound. My eyes narrowed and Lake gave her a quelling look.
How did you connect Maggie to Grierson?
He asked. I canvassed all the bars Maggie's friends said she liked to visit and got nothing, just like the cops did. I started checking other bars close to her apartment and didn't have much luck until I got to the bar we were in tonight. The bartender there said Maggie had been in a couple of times, and he thought he remembered her with a flashy guy who liked to brag about his car. I got a physical description and a first name. I staked out the area for a couple of nights until I saw a guy matching the description parking his Porsche in the alley behind the steakhouse. I followed him home that night. That was about a week ago. That was before we got the surveillance footage. Parker's tone made it clear she wasn't happy I had identified their suspect before they did. I continued. Once I had Grierson's name and address, I did some digging into his background. It didn't take long to figure out that he was a half-demon. I'd already guessed it from his size. As I talked, Lake wrote in a little notebook. He paused at the last, his eyes narrowing at me.
Why didn't you pass his information on to the police or SPEMA?
At that point, it wasn't anything more than a possible lead. I needed something that would tie Grierson to Maggie, or to one of the other girls. I hoped I could find physical evidence I could give the police.
Did you find any evidence?
How familiar are you with magic trace, Agent Lake? Parker snorted. Lake's mouth compressed into a grim line.
Parker, Mr. Grierson's vehicle and the alley behind McGovern's are a crime scene. I need you to head there and request a CSU.
I can't leave you here alone with a suspect, Parker said. It's against regulations.
She's not a suspect. She's a witness. I'll call in for additional agents and a second CSU,
Lake told her.
We'll be fine here in the meantime. Go secure the other scene.
Seething, Parker spun around and headed off in the direction of the park gate. Lake watched her go, then turned back to me.
I'll have to report this soon. She'll be sending more agents out here.
In other words, get to the point.
I tucked my cold hands into my jacket pockets. Maggie and the rest of the girls went missing the day before a full moon. I suspected the timing might indicate some sort of ritual magic. I went to Grierson's house to look around. When I got close enough, I could sense traces of what felt like a demon summoning. It was strong enough that I could sense it through the house wards, which meant, if I was right, Grierson had summoned a very powerful demon. It was hard to tell in the moonlight, but I thought Blake looked pale.
What did you do then?
The house wards were strong enough that if I tried to unweave or break them, he would know immediately. I asked an acquaintance to come with me and try scrying, to see if he could see anything that might have taken place in the house. I'd cashed in a big favor to get Michael to do it. A pause.
What am I going to find in that house, Ms. Worth?
Not what you were hoping to find, I told him. You'll need to unweave or break Grierson's house wards first. You'll find a basement with black wards. Make sure you bring a strong blood mage, and beware that it will take some time to get through.
What's in the basement? Blake demanded.
A very large summoning circle. Grierson was summoning his father from the demon realm and using the girl's blood to bring him over on the night of the full moon.
When the boundary between the demon realm and ours is thinnest.
Yes. Another pause.
Did Grierson kill the girls to bring his father over?
I hesitated.
Tell me.
The agent commanded, stepping back up into my personal space. Despite our height difference, I didn't move away. Grierson used their blood for the summoning circle. When the demon appeared, he ate them. Blake staggered back like I'd hit him. When Michael saw what happened to Maggie, he'd vomited, packed up his scrying mirror, and told me to never call him again. He wouldn't even let me take him home. He called a cab and walked away without a backward glance. I'm not sure you'll find any physical evidence showing that the girls died in the basement, I said as Blake visibly reeled. He probably used a burner spell to clean up the blood, but you may find something else that puts the victims in his house. Hair, fingerprints, maybe bone fragments. Michael had told me enough before he walked off for me to know that Maggie hadn't died quickly. Demons liked to play with their food. Blake stared at me.
Please tell me the hills don't know how she died.
No, I said, and he looked relieved. I told them she was sacrificed as part of a summoning ritual, and it was over quickly.
What were you going to do with Grierson?
At the request of Maggie's parents, I was going to turn him over to the vampires. The Hills believed, as did I, that the best chance for them and the rest of the families to get justice was in vampire court. They wanted him punished, and the vampires have the facilities to ensure he wouldn't have known an hour of peace for the rest of his long and miserable life. I didn't want Grierson dead. I wanted him to suffer. If Blake was taken aback by that, he didn't show it.
If he did clean the basement with a burner spell, there might not be any physical evidence left. The vampire court could have been the only chance for a conviction. None of the magic-related evidence would have been admissible in human court.
He seemed to be reasoning out loud to himself. I let him think. Finally, Blake turned to me.
All of the victims had long dark hair and were similar in height and body type. We speculated it was the work of a serial killer.
I don't think you were wrong, I told him. He selected his victims based on their appearance. It's possible that if you dig into his past, you'll find the woman he hated, who he felt he needed to kill over and over again. He needed blood for the summoning, but he didn't need to feed the girls to his father. He enjoyed watching them suffer. After a moment, Blake said,
You went into that bar and used yourself as bait, knowing you were his type. You risked your life to get justice for Maggie and the other girls.
I could see grudging respect in his eyes. I stayed quiet. Lake turned back to Grierson's body, his face set.
You need to leave. The official report is going to say that we confronted Grierson in the alley and then chased him into the park where he died resisting arrest. I don't need to tell you that saying anything to the contrary would be inadvisable.
What about your partner?
Parker's report will match mine. I'll be visiting with the Hills privately. Other than sending them a bill for your services, I don't think there's any need for you to have further contact with them, do you?
His tone made it clear that it would be in my best interest to agree. Ah, there it was. That trademark Spima arrogance. It was a good reminder that when it came down to it, even someone like Lake, who obviously cared a great deal about getting justice for Grierson's victims, had no trouble letting me know exactly who had the power in this scenario. I'd identified a serial killer, risked my life to capture him, and revealed what happened in Grierson's basement, but it was Lake calling all the shots. If he was worried that I wanted publicity, I could at least dispel that notion. You can have the credit. I don't care about any of that. If everything had gone according to plan, no one outside the vampire court would have ever known I was involved, except the Hills.
Good.
Lake bent down and picked up my phone, healing spell, cuffs, and a few other items Parker had dropped on the ground, and handed them to me, along with my wallet.
Take your stuff and go.
I put my possessions back in my pockets and paused, looking at Grierson's body. It was just beginning to sink in that I'd killed him. He was far from the first person to die by my hand, but at least I had no doubt he'd deserved his fate. So many others hadn't. I took a shaky breath. Lake had his phone out.
What are you waiting for?
I turned on my heel and headed for the main gate. Behind me, I heard Lake barking orders into his phone. I resisted the urge to hold my side as I walked, even though each step sent a bolt of pain through my ribs. The moon disappeared behind the clouds, and I shivered. Nausea surged, and I paused just outside the park gate, leaning against a lamppost while I swallowed hard. It was the closest I'd come in 5 years to getting caught. Part of me wanted to run, to put as much distance between myself and Lake as I could. But I forced myself to walk calmly and not attract attention. My car was 6 blocks away, 8 if I took a route that completely avoided Parker and the alley behind McGovern's, which seemed like a good idea. My feet and calves were starting to hurt. But I could make it. I'd go home, use a healing spell on my ribs, and crawl into bed. In my mind, in an endless loop, I saw the glint of a blade and the bright green flash of my cold fire, and heard the sound of Grierson's knife going into his brain. I wrapped my arms around my middle and walked. My boot heels echoed like gunshots on the empty street. Chapter 2. 2 weeks later.
The worst part about being a ghost, the ghost confided, is that you don't get to pick who you end up haunting. I know that seems counterintuitive, but there is a system. Of course, you can put in a request, but there are a ton of forms to fill out, which is a bitch if you're non-corporeal. By the time all the paperwork goes through, what usually ends up happening is you get someone from the priority list. The list of people who deserve to have a demented spirit running around ruining their lives. And that, he added happily, clicking his long pointed fingernails together, is how I ended up here with you.
Fantastic, I sighed. All three of the ghosts' faces were hideous. One visage was alight with excitement, his red goat eyes with their slit pupils zipping around my office, taking in the economical furnishings. Another set of eyes, so black they seemed more like holes than actual eyes, focused on my MPI license where it hung, slightly crooked, on the wall above my head. The third set, the multifaceted eyes of a spider set in an arachnid head, were fixed on my face. His black robes moved as though hordes of beetles crawled on his body beneath the silk. An unidentified purplish-black goo dripped from his fangs. I had to give him credit. He was thoroughly gruesome. I blew out a breath. Look, nothing personal, but I'm probably going to have you exercised. I can't afford to have a ghost on the payroll. The soup insurance alone would kill me. Three sets of angry eyes focused on my face.
Is that supposed to be a joke about me being dead? Because I find that to be in particularly poor taste.
Honestly, I really don't care. Two monstrous mouths fell open in shock. One was full of rows of very sharp, jagged teeth, while in the other, spider fangs clacked in consternation. The third face, the one with the black nothingness eyes, had no mouth. He'd probably been expecting a much different reaction, based on the form he'd chosen to take. I might not be his first haunting, but I was going to be his last. I had no use for petty ghosts who got their kicks trying to make living humans miserable, even if I had earned my spot on the priority list. Some would say that threatening exorcisms or making puns about death to a ghost was cruel, but I'd never really gotten the hang of being nice. While the ghost sputtered in indignation, I picked absently at the underside of my new desk. A particularly disgruntled client with surprisingly powerful telekinetic powers threw a fit in my office a little over a week ago, and I was still trying to get repairs completed and the furniture replaced. The remains of the old desk, along with pretty much everything else that had been in the office, were now in the dumpster out back. The large cabinet behind my desk, a heavily warded antique, was the only piece of furniture to withstand the dwarf's tantrum. The sole other survivor was my framed mage private investigator license, though it looked a bit worse for wear. The ghost finally recovered his power of speech and gave me a truly grotesque arachnid smile.
"I see you're an MPI, Alice Evelyn Worth," he said silkily. "Surely someone in your line of work has use for someone with particular talents."
I scoffed. "How long were you in the null since your last haunting? Ghosts aren't a new thing anymore. If I need to get results, I'd have better luck summoning a demon or hiring one of those crazy half-vamps, a dampier. At least people are scared of them." "You are not scary." The ghost's red goat eyes flared in anger. I met his gaze without fear. He wasn't the first nightmare form ghost to show up in my life, and I'd dispatched all the others as quickly as they'd arrived. There wasn't anything he could do or say that would make me want to keep him around. Of course, just as I thought that, he proved me wrong. The ghost raised his clawed hand. Bright blue and green flames danced along his fingertips. Drawing on my air magic, I threw up a protective circle around me and my chair, just as my desk, and everything on it and in it, went up in cold bluish-green flames. In seconds, there was nothing left but ash. It was my turn to be momentarily speechless. "Well, that's different," I said finally. Turns out, the ghost had a very particular set of skills. Skills that had apparently put him at odds with someone who decided he didn't need to be walking around alive anymore. Now, rather intrigued, I poured myself a cup of coffee from the coffee pot that had, thankfully, been sitting on the little table behind me and not on the second desk I watched get destroyed in the past week. I used my desk generally to make my office look more professional and to create a psychological barrier between myself and my clients. I'd been forced several times to use a desk as a shield and twice as a weapon. The new desk hadn't been around long enough to be used as any of those things. The ghost looked disappointed that I wasn't all that upset about the loss of my desk and its contents, but I'd long ago ceased to worry about the destruction of office furniture. When you're a PI specializing in the paranormal and supernatural, it didn't pay to get attached to office decor. Not all my clients left satisfied, and the nature of my business often brought angry soups of various species to my door, which, though heavily warded, has had to be replaced 6 times in 3 years. I wasn't very popular with the building's management. The ghost watched me sip my coffee. I couldn't help but notice he was smirking. The spider mouth might also be sneering, but it was hard to tell. Well, I still planned to have him exercised, so that ought to wipe those smiles right off. He'd thrown me a pretty epic curveball with the speed and precision of his cold fire, though, and I was curious about his past. If nothing else, I'd be adding to my knowledge of ghost abilities, and that was worth 15 minutes of talking with this dead jerk. "Tell me about yourself," I said. With no desk to put it on, I held my coffee cup and made unflinching eye contact with my uninvited guest. The ghost's goat eyes sparkled with something like humor. Strangely enough, most ghosts found their situation funny, even when their deaths were violent and unexpected. I had to yet figure out why this would be the case. My working theory was that being in the null for any length of time made them all a little unhinged.
"My name is Malcolm," the ghost said slowly, as if recalling his own name took a moment. "I was a mage."
I snorted and gestured toward the pile of ash that had once been a perfectly respectable secondhand desk.
"No shit."
He made a raspy, wheezing noise that I realized was laughter. While his goat head was speaking to me, the other two sets of eyes went back to looking around my office. The three pairs of eyes looking in different directions were starting to make me feel queasy. "What kind of mage?" I asked.
"Earth,"
he said, confirming my suspicions. The cold fire was unique to earth mages. Then he surprised me again.
"And water."
My eyebrows raised, despite my intention to stay only mildly interested. "Earth and water? That's very unusual." I carefully opened my shields enough to get a better sense of the ghost's magic. I recognized the cool blue of his water magic and the peaceful green of earth magic. His aura sizzled along my senses. I realized he was definitely a high-level mage and well-trained. His control of his cold fire was precise.
"Usually enough for me to end up on a good payroll,"
Malcolm was saying as my senses turned outward again.
"It was good living for a while."
He stopped talking, and the goat's eyes wandered over to look out the window. Since it looked out on the dirty bricks of the building next door, I figured he wasn't lost in the view. "Let me guess," I said. All three sets of eyes suddenly focused on my face. "Everything was great at first. Then they started asking you to do things you didn't like. Then things you didn't want to do. Then things you'd swore you'd never do. And then things that made you not be able to sleep at night or look at yourself in the mirror. And then..." I stopped. I noticed that my hands had clenched and forced them to relax.
"And then I died."
I nodded. These days, it was a common story.
"I worked for Darius Bell."
For a moment, the ghost sounded almost proud, then his shoulders slumped. I was sure at one point he'd been honored to be a part of Bell's cabal, one of the most powerful, wealthy, and well-connected on the West Coast. Hard on the heels of that flash of pride would be the recollection that his boss had him killed, and that for all his hard work and loyalty, he was rewarded with what had probably been a very unpleasant exit from this plane of existence. The ghost, who I was grudgingly starting to think of as Malcolm, despite every effort not to, damn it, settled in to tell his story. Apparently tired of the effort it took to maintain all three nightmarish countenances, he suddenly reformed with a single human face and head, with spiky blonde hair and bright blue eyes. His robes turned into a button-up shirt and jeans. His claws retracted into his sleeves, then pushed back out as normal, even delicate-looking human hands. Transformation complete, he peered at me through the wire frames of quite unnecessary glasses. After all, who'd ever heard of a nearsighted ghost? The affectation was almost quirky and completely unexpected after the gruesomeness of his nightmare form. I had no idea whether this was how Malcolm appeared when he was alive, but now he looked like a cute librarian. The total package, I had to admit, was not unpleasant. You know, for a dead guy.
I went to work for Darius right out of college, Malcolm said. Well, I say that, but it's not really true. I left college to work for him. 2 semesters to go before I had my chemistry degree and probably a decent career as a research chemist. And I let a recruiter hand me a signing bonus, and the next thing I knew, I was signing a 10-year contract and moving across the country.
I whistled. A 10-year contract and a signing bonus? Malcolm must have had some serious talent. I looked at my non-corporeal guest with new respect. I felt a familiar hollowness when I thought of the years I spent as a mage for my grandfather's cabal. The sleepless nights, the misery, the blood, both literal and metaphorical, on my hands. Even now I could see the telltale signs of blood magic in my aura that even the strongest spellwork couldn't hide completely. If it weren't for my spelled tattoos, my bloody history would be visible for any ghost or sensitive to see. I wrapped my hands around my mug and refocused my attention on Malcolm's face. Behind those superfluous glasses, Malcolm's eyes looked concerned. Troubled? I raised my eyebrows, waiting for him to continue his story, and hoping he couldn't see anything in my aura but the light smudges of someone who'd only dabbled in blood magic once or twice. Malcolm went on.
At first, they gave me the best assignments, bringing rain to crops that needed it, enriching the grounds for farmers, shoring up land for housing developments, nothing bad or even questionable. I felt good about the work I did. I spent the first year wondering where all those horror stories about the cabals came from. I finally decided the stories were made up by anti-magic activists and people who weren't good enough to work for the cabals. I really believed it was all lies. God, I was so stupid.
He hung his head. I stayed silent. In a weird way, I envied Malcolm's lost innocence. As the granddaughter of Moses Miriam Murphy, I'd never had the luxury of not knowing the truth about the cabals. My earliest memories of magic involved the suffering of others, and always, always the pursuit of profit and power. The two things Moses Murphy and Darius Bell and pretty much every other cabal leader, or Davo, lived for. While there were certainly plenty of smaller cabals out there that had no interest in criminal activities, and whose members used their magic to help rather than harm, all of the very powerful ones were organized crime syndicates. These cabals, like any other criminal organization, ran on brutal efficiency, demanded unwavering loyalty, and cared about two things: money and power. There were a dozen major cabals in the U.S. and a host of smaller ones, each run by a more powerful Davo and his or her lieutenants. Like the mafia, cabals made money through various criminal enterprises. Mages bound to cabals did whatever was required to make these ventures profitable. Malcolm was speaking again.
So, after about a year of getting the cushy, easy jobs, they started me on the ones I didn't really like very much, causing droughts and floods, destabilizing the ground under particular building projects, disrupting shipping routes. Then they came to me with the rough stuff. Landslides, washouts, attacks on construction sites and building projects owned by other cabals. People were hurt. People died. I tried to refuse, but that contract.
He rubbed his wrists with recollected pain, and my own wrists throbbed in sympathy. I remembered all too well the agony of trying to break a contract once I had been forced to accept it. The crippling, white-hot lashes of pain that scoured my body whenever I tried to refuse to carry out an assignment. Even now, just hearing the word contract still brought on nausea at unexpected moments.
It got worse and worse, Malcolm continued. By that time, I realized the stories about the cabals were true, and they weren't even close to the worst things they were responsible for. But something tells me,
he said, regarding me much too closely for my own comfort,
that you know that just as well as I do.
What I know or don't know is none of your business, Ghost. I snapped, setting my forgotten mug down on the side table so hard that lukewarm coffee sloshed over the side. I stood up. Malcolm's eyes went suddenly wide with fear. The familiar power of my magic surged and swirled around me. Unlike Malcolm's brightly colored earth and water magic, mine was black and red and purple, dark and malevolent and dangerous. Without me having to consciously call for it, the energy spooled around my fists, waiting to be unleashed.
Blood magic, he whispered.
If it was possible for a ghost to turn pale, Malcolm was doing it. And now he knew how I got on that priority list. The mid-morning sunshine poured in through my office windows, glittering on dust particles in the air. The light was diffused as it passed through my guest and made strange, indistinct shadows on the floor. We stood unmoving, Malcolm frozen in place with fear and me struggling to get control of my anger. It took nearly a full minute, but I pulled the magic back inside myself and the residual energy faded. When my arms finally stopped prickling, I breathed deeply, sat back down in my chair, and looked across the pile of ash at Malcolm. Despite his initial fear, he looked calmer now that I no longer seemed like an immediate threat. It occurred to me then that his death could have been at the hands of a blood mage, and that my loss of control might have triggered some very unpleasant memories. Malcolm eyed me with obvious unease.
I'm sorry I upset you.
It's fine. I started cleaning up the spilled coffee with a handful of Kleenex. Malcolm waited silently. Finally, I dropped the gloppy wet tissues into the trash can and turned back to him. So they were giving you assignments you didn't want, I prompted. Malcolm nodded.
I had no choice but to do what they told me. I belonged to the cabal for 10 years, but I didn't make it that long, obviously. By my 4th year, I was fighting them every step of the way. I'd developed a tolerance for the pain, and it was taking them longer and longer to get me to comply. Sometimes I'd be unconscious for days, and they'd end up having to use a different mage who wasn't as strong. I told them I wanted different work or I wanted out of my contract. This went on for another year.
I was surprised Malcolm resisted his contract so openly for that long and survived as long as he did. It was a testimony to how talented he was that A, he'd been strong enough to resist the power of the contract, and B, that the cabal had been unwilling to kill him for resisting. To the end, I doubted Bell really wanted to kill Malcolm. A strong mage with both earth and water magic was a rare gem, one that any Davo would be very reluctant to part with. So what finally got you killed? I asked. Despite the bluntness of my question, he laughed a little.
Well, that's pretty direct, he said. I guess they finally got tired of my shit, figured out that I wasn't going to stop fighting. They handed me over to a blood mage. 3 days later, I was dead.
I was right then. He'd been killed by a blood mage. A normal person probably would have felt guilty for unleashing blood magic in front of a ghost who had died that way. But thanks to my grandfather, I had never really been any kind of a normal person. The best I could come up with was some empathy. Those 3 days had probably felt like 300 years. I was willing to bet Malcolm had welcomed death in the end. After even an hour with a blood mage, many would. I knew that from personal experience. Suddenly, realization hit me. Wait, how are you here? I asked in confusion. How did you end up bound to me instead of Bell's cabal? Malcolm shook his head.
I don't know. I was under contract when I died, so I should be back at the cabal.
He shuddered. Bound ghosts were often simply stored in spell crystals and foci, where their energy could be used in spell work and continuously drained like magical, self-charging batteries. It was a horrible fate for any mage.
Unless Darius freed me, but why would he do that?
I have no idea. I can't imagine he would let a mage as powerful and skilled as you be unbound.
But what other explanation is there?
Malcolm asked.
It's got to be punishment of some sort, but I can't think of a scenario where being a bound ghost isn't worse than coming back as a haunt. Sorry about that, by the way,
he added. I shrugged. Not your fault.
Maybe he expected me not to come back as a ghost, and instead end up in the underworld. Considering the things I did, I can't imagine that would be very pleasant for me.
I sat back and thought. Why would Darius Bell do something as unheard of as let a mage's ghost be unbound? Malcolm's theory of punishment was possible, I supposed. Death wasn't necessarily the end of suffering. Ghosts, unless exorcised, remained incorporeally on Earth, tied to a person or place, tormented by their inability to connect with their loved ones or find peace and rest. If exorcised, they went to the underworld, but as Malcolm said, there was no guarantee he'd find any peace or rest there. I didn't know the extent of the things he did while working for the Cabal, but I could guess. There were a lot of theories, few of them cheerful, about what happens to those in the afterlife who caused suffering in this one, even if they were coerced into doing so. So, had Bell freed Malcolm so he would be unbound? If so, why? Had he wanted to ensure Malcolm ended up in the underworld? He could just as easily have destroyed Malcolm's essence completely, wiping him out of existence. But it would mean Malcolm would no longer be suffering. So if punishment was the goal, I could see some kind of logic in sentencing Malcolm to a non-corporeal afterlife. But somehow it didn't seem right. To say cabal mages never got their contracts nullified and their ghosts unbound would be an understatement. What was less frequent than never? Was there a word for that? Never-er, never-est? That was how often it happened. So this had to be an extraordinary circumstance. I raised my eyes to look at Malcolm, who clearly shared my unease.
You don't think it's punishment?
I don't. Not in the way you're thinking. It's something else. There's a plan for you. It may involve more suffering. In fact, it almost certainly does. But it's not as simple as just condemning you to being a ghost and haunting someone like me. I fell silent. Malcolm's face went blank, but I could feel his disquiet as if it was my own. For some reason, I couldn't quite articulate. There was something very disturbing about Malcolm's story, beyond the obvious parts about the things he was forced to do while under contract, or his terrible death at the hands of a blood mage. I couldn't shake the feeling there was something going on in Bell's cabal, and that Malcolm being bound to me was a clue to it, which meant I wasn't going to be exercising Malcolm now or anytime soon. Not until I had some answers. I stood, and Malcolm floated back a few inches. "Well," I said with a sigh, "welcome to Looking Glass Investigations. You're the newest member of the team." Chapter 3. Article 1, Section 34.1 of the Supernatural and Paranormal Entity Registration Act stated that I had 72 hours to register my new ghost with SPEMA. That, I believed quite sincerely, was going to be a problem. If Bell had indeed given Malcolm his freedom so that the mage would return to Earth as a ghost, then he would be watching the agency's registration system for his name to pop up. And then the entire cabal would be on my doorstep. I had a bad feeling nothing would keep them from taking both of us. It would likely mean either my death, my undeath, or my return to the cabal I'd escaped 5 years ago. Obviously, I wasn't going to be making that call to the agency. "How long have you been dead?" I asked Malcolm, hands on my hips, as I thought about what to do with the pile of ash that had been my desk and its contents.
I don't know."
I glanced at him with raised eyebrows.
"Things have been a little crazy," he said defensively. "I wasn't really thinking clearly when I died, and it's not like I had a watch or a calendar. What's the date?"
I told him. He stared at me, clearly stunned.
Almost 3 years? I've been gone that long?"
"Apparently." I turned away to give him some space to process that revelation. I went to the storage closet and emerged with a broom, dustpan, and bucket. I'd long ago given up on having carpet in my office and restored the bare, stained concrete. What it lacked in aesthetics, it made up for in convenience when it came to cleaning up the inevitable messes my visitors tended to leave behind. There were other benefits as well. My second sight revealed the shimmer of the circle I'd inlaid into the floor around my chair. The ash had settled around it in a semicircle, the only visible hint of the circle's existence.
"Let me."
Malcolm started to reach for the broom, then stopped with a grimace.
"I'm sorry about the mess," he said instead.
"Don't worry about it." I swept ash into the dustpan and dumped it into the bucket. There really wasn't as much ash as you might think there would be. Magical fires didn't tend to leave as much behind as mundane ones. Even entire houses and all their contents would be consumed and leave less ash than would fill the bucket I was using. Memory flooded through me, despite my best efforts to keep those images locked away. My fingers tightened on the broom handle, and for a moment it was hard to breathe.
"Are you all right?"
Malcolm floated a little closer. "I'm fine," I said shortly, focusing on sweeping. "You could never get it all, though, really," I thought absently. I'd have to clean it with more than just a broom or mop to remove the traces of Malcolm's magic. I didn't need anyone knowing I'd had a high-level earth and water mage in my office, much less a dead one. Once the ash was swept up, I put the dustpan and broom into the bucket and left it sitting in the middle of the floor where the desk had been. "I need to get rid of this," I told Malcolm. "If we're going to keep you off the radar as long as possible, there can't be any of your magic trace left behind. So try not to incinerate anything else. If you do, just use basic earth magic. That's easy enough to disperse."
"Do you think it's possible to hide me from Darius and his people?"
I made a face. "Honestly, I'm not sure how long we can keep you under wraps. I'm not about to register you with the agency, but that doesn't guarantee your, our secret is safe." It occurred to me that the consequences of breaking one of Spira's most strictly enforced laws would probably mean I'd never see daylight again if we were caught. And if the rumors were true, I'd probably be begging for death before it was all over. I saw a flash of blood-splattered room and heard an echo of my own screams. Ice seemed to form in my veins, and suddenly my vision tunneled. And again it was hard to get a breath.
Sit down,"
Malcolm was saying, as if from a long way away. I found my chair and sat, bending over to put my head between my knees. I focused on breathing deeply and slowly. The ghost hovered a few feet away. Finally, I raised my head to look at Malcolm. I don't know what my face looked like, but he flitted back a few feet in that way ghosts could move when they got really spooked, so to speak. I smiled mirthlessly at my pun, and something in my expression made him flit again. "This could be a death sentence for me," I said quietly. "And there are rumors that there are punishments for ghosts as well, not just exorcism. I've heard there are traps that capture the ghost, and..." I paused. "Blood mages designed the traps to torment the ghosts. I don't know the details, but we can assume it would be better for both of us if we stay far away from Spima." Malcolm looked anguished. "If it comes down to it, I'll try to have you exorcised before they can catch you. If that's not possible, I can discorporate you." His eyes widened as he realized what I meant. My own special set of blood mage skills included the permanent dispersal of a ghost's non-corporeal form. It wasn't something I did very often, and I only ever discorporated wraiths and poltergeists. They were so far gone by that point, they didn't know what was happening to them. But Malcolm would be self-aware enough to know. I spoke quietly, but purposefully. It would mean a one-way trip to the underworld. But some might say that would be preferable to ending up in one of those traps. I need to know ahead of time if that's what you want, because we may not have time to think or talk if the agency or a cabal catches us. I'll have a few seconds, at most, just long enough to...
"Do it," Malcolm broke in. "If it comes to that, send me on. I don't know what will happen to me down there, but I know I don't want to spend eternity in a trap, or back at the cabal being used as a focus."
He stopped as realization dawned.
"But if you spend those last few seconds taking care of me, you won't be able to do anything to defend yourself. They'll take you."
I didn't tell him that I had one final option standing between me and the tortures of the agency or a cabal. Inside my left leg, a so-called divine wind spell was carved into my femur. Only the most sensitive and focused X-ray would be able to spot it, and it couldn't be sensed before I invoked it. It was basically my nuclear option, and one I would never use unless I had no hope of escape. I knew it was a better alternative than the suffering I would have to look forward to at the hands of either the agency or a cabal. And if my grandfather ever caught me, well, nuking myself would be the only choice. At least I would take a lot of them with me when I went, in true kamikaze style. I resisted the urge to glance down at my leg and struggled with a nonchalance I certainly didn't feel. "Odds are if they catch on to us, they'll send a small army. I'm strong, but not strong enough to take on the kind of combined firepower they'd send. The best I can do is try to keep you from being caught. At some point, we need to figure out why Bell gave you your soul back." I had no earthly idea how we were going to do that. But what the hell? It was a Wednesday, and I always came up with lofty goals on Wednesdays. My phone beeped, a reminder that I had a downtown lunch appointment with a potential client at noon. I turned to my new ghost companion. "We've got to head out. Can you leave the office and hang out unseen in the hallway for a moment? I need to clean up in here." Malcolm nodded and vanished. I waited until I could sense that he had gone past my wards before pulling some of the energy to me that had spindled earlier. I focused on the little tickle in my senses that represented the remaining traces of Malcolm's earth and water magic. Obliterate. The metaphysical blast that radiated out from me would have staggered a less powerful mage. But long years of practice and training kept me steady as the wave swept through my office, taking apart Malcolm's handiwork and dispersing it. The atoms weren't gone, of course. Magic still obeyed physical laws. In less than a heartbeat, no trace of ash remained, in the bucket, on any surface, or in the air. In a few minutes, even the trace of his energy would disperse. The air felt heavy and smelled like ozone, as it always did when I used magic in an enclosed space. I peeked into the bucket for a visual confirmation of what my senses already told me. The ash was capital G gone. I stuck the cleaning supplies back in the closet, grabbed my messenger bag, and locked up the office. I could feel Malcolm's presence nearby like a gentle, distinctly blue-green pressure in my mind. But he stayed invisible as we traveled down the elevator to the parking garage below the office building. Neither of us said a word until we were in my car and on our way out of the garage. Finally, I gave voice to what had been going through my head. I have a spell that should mask your energy. To other mages, you should feel like a non-magical spirit. If you don't attract attention to yourself, it should hold up fine. But I don't have time to do the spell work right now. To find something that will withstand scrutiny, I'm going to have to do some work. Depending on what this case is, I might be able to look into that tonight. You're going to have to stay invisible until we can work something up.
How do we keep other mages or ghosts from sensing me in the meantime?
Malcolm's voice was quiet, either because he wasn't manifesting physically or from apprehension, or both. I have a thought, I said slowly, but you may not like it. When I walked into Janie's downtown cafe 45 minutes later, I walked in alone. I told the hostess my name and said I was meeting someone. She glanced down at her notepad, then pointed. Redhead in the third booth from the back, she's been here 15 minutes already. There was clear disapproval in her tone. I glanced up at the clock and frowned. I wasn't late. It was only just noon. I'd intended to be here 10 minutes ago, but construction caused me to have problems finding a place to park. Plus, there had been the matter of dealing with Malcolm. I resisted the urge to touch.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.